Hello students, welcome again. I am Professor Poonam Gharge. Today I will talk about emasculation and hybridization techniques in sorghum crop. So the common name of sorghum is Jawar, Jola, Jona. In our state we called it Jori or Jondhra, while the scientific name is Sorghum bicolor. And chromosome number is 2N is equal to 20. Sorghum is originated from Ethiopia, while its progenitors are Sorghum arundinaceum, which is having a chromosome number 2N is equal to 2X is equal to 20, while another one is a Sorghum sudanis, which is also having a chromosome number 2N is equal to 20. So both are the diploid species. As per the Harlan and DeWitt classification, which is given in 1972, there are 5 basic races of this sorghum subspecies bicolor is identified for this cultivated one. While we are also, he gave the classification in that he identified 10 hybrid races. So basic races, these are the first one is race bicolor, race gunia, race caudatum, race kaffir, race dura. So we are going to see their characteristic in detail in the next slide. So first one is race bicolor. So if you see in this picture, this first picture, the grain is elongated, sometimes it have a slightly ovate shape, nearly symmetrical, dorsoventrally glumes, collapsing the grain, which may be completely covered or exposed. Then second one is caudatum. So grains, here you can see in second picture, these grains markedly, if you see, they are having a asymmetrical shape. The side next to the lower glume is flat, while somewhat concave. The opposite side is rounded and bulging. The persistent of style often at the tip of a big point pointing towards the lower gum. Here you can see a small persistent style is present on that grain, which is pointing toward the lower gum, half the length of the grain or less sometimes. Then another one is the sorghum dura. So dura is having a round or ovate shaped grain, bulging and widest above the middle, which is wedge shaped at the base, glooms very wide at the tip, of a different texture from the base, and often with a transverse crease is present. If you see in this picture, this is a dura, this one is gunia, and this one is kaffir. So gunia, the grains are having a flat shape, dorsoventrally sublenticular in outline, twisting at a maturity nearly 90 degree angle between gaping inovate glooms that are formed nearly as long to longer than the grain, while kaffir is more or less spherical in shape, not twisting, glooms collapsing, and they are variable in length. Then hybrid races are, first one is race gunia bicolor, then caudatum bicolor, dura bicolor, gunia caudatum, gunia kaffir, gunia dura, kaffir caudatum, dura caudatum, kaffir dura, and last one is kaffir bicolor. So this classification is based on the mature spikelet. Then next point is morphology of sorghum plant. So if you see sorghum habit is, it is an annual and herbaceous plant, which is having a herbaceous stem, succulent stem little bit, and these plants are going to complete their life cycle within one season or 1 year. Therefore it is an annual in habit. Then root system, so roots are adventitious and fibrous, here you can see. So sometimes we will also get a stilt root that is emerged out from the nodal region. So these are the root which is present above the soil surface, which is emerged out from the first node. on the stem and they are providing somewhat support to the main stem. Then stem, if you see this stem, so this stem is erect, solid, several feet high, made up of nodes and internode. The pith may be sweet. If you test the juice, it is a have a sweeter taste, little bit juicy, or sometimes it is dry. Then leaves. Leaves are simple, alternate, sessile, long, lanceolate. You can see lanceolate means at towards both end they are having a narrow shape, while the middle portion is little bit larger. So lanceolate, distinct sheathing base, that is a leaf sheath is there. The margins of the leaf sheath are membranous. You can see here. And overlapping. So you can see in this picture, these margins are going to overlap on one another end. So leaves are near about 7 to 28 arranged on a main stem, having a opposite direction. They are alternate and opposite to each other on main stem with parallel venation. If you see, veins are parallel to this main midrib. So this prominent portion is called as a midrib, and these veins are parallel to this midrib. Then ligule. So ligule is short, membranous and fringe, present at the junction of the leaf sheath and the leaf blade. So here this is a leaf sheath and this is a leaf blade. So jointing this leaf sheath with leaf blade, we are having a ligule. So this portion is called as a ligule. Then next point is inflorescence. So usually we are having a compact panicle, sometimes loose and spreading. You can observe, see here, or sometimes it is a compact. The main axis is called as a rachis, which is having a narrow shape towards the apex. So when it is from base to apex, it is become narrower, and it is not identified in the terminal or subterminal branches. So at the end you cannot make a distinguish between this rachis, because it is somewhat angular and furrowed, hairy at the nodes. So the internode may be hairy or may not. At the nodes, lateral branches may develop into whorls or in spiral shape. So lateral branches are produced on this rachis, either in whorls or in a spiral shape. So each lateral branch may rebranch again, and on the ultimate branch, lets one or a branchlets, one to many paired spikelets are produced. So the lateral branches are somewhat angular and hairy at the base and at the axils. Somewhat the heads of panicle becomes inverted. So in the next picture you can see, here you can see the loose panicle inside flag leaf. So this is a flag leaf. Here you can see the main axis, central axis, that is called as rachis, and from this rachis you are having a primary branches. So the inflorescence is a panicle with central rachis, from which many primary branches are arises, on which again secondary and sometimes you will get a tertiary branches which carry the raceme of spikelet. So here you can see another loose panicle where you can clearly see main rachis, then primary branch which is arising from the main rachis, and on this main branch you will see here there are secondary branches. So this is a compact panicle which is also bear a central axis, and in on this central axis you are having a many primary branches and secondary branches. So secondary branches are going to bear the racemes or a pedicels, whatever we are having, of those spikelet. Then spikelet, so panicle consists of these spikelets in pair. So sessile is a hermaphrodite one, while fertile, while another one is a pedicel. So in this spikelet, one spikelet is sessile while another one is having a pedicel. So sessile is hermaphrodite and fertile one, while the pedicellate one, those spikelet arise on pedicel, which is a sterile in nature. Sessile spikelet consist of then inner and outer glumes, in which two flowers are present. Upper one is a perfect flower, while lower one is a reduced one. The perfect flower has a thin, narrow, hairy lemma and small pilea, enclosing three stamens, two lodicles and bifidary stigma. The pedicellate flower is without pilea and ovary. Otherwise, it is having an inner and outer gloom, as well as it is having a lemma and stamens. So here you can see parts of panicle. So this is your primary branch, on which you are having a secondary branches, and on this secondary branches you are having a spikelet. So each spikelet is a pair of spikelet. Here you can see through which one on a spine like structure is there emerged out, that is called as on. So here you can see pair of spikelet. So this pedicelled one is a sterile, while another one which is without pedicel is called as a sessile spikelet, which is hermaphrodite, means it has a both a female and male reproductive organ, and which bears a on shaped structure. So this is a structure of your spikelet. So if you go into depth, sometimes the terminal spikelet is having a one sessile and a pair of pedicellate spikelet. If you see the terminal spikelet in the panicle, we are having one sessile spikelet and two pedicellate spikelets. So pedicellate spikelets are sterile, while sessile are only perfect one. So here you can see again a clear picture of this. So both two pedicellate and one sterile spikelet is there. So if you see the flower is sessile, perfect, bracteate, zygomorphic, irregular and hypogynous. So perianth is present here, which is represented by two short and broad fleshy hairy lodicles. Androecium, three stamens are present inside a single flower, which is having a filament. So filaments are free, anthers are biceled and versatile in nature. Next point is gynoecium. So single carpel is present inside your sterile spikelet. So it is called as a monocarpellary. Ovary is superior, unilocular, with single basal anthropous ovule. So basal placentation is there, with two long style ending in a short bushy stigma. So bifidary stigma is there. Suprute is called as a caryopsis, which is varied in shape and color. Usually it has a white or pale color. Seed is albuminous, means endospermic in nature. Then floral formula, here you can see the percentage sign, means the flower is zygomorphic. Here you can see bisexual symbol. So flower is bisexual, bears both, present both male and female organ. Then P2 means two lodicles are there, perianth, two lodicles is there. Then anthers, three anthers are there, and G is single, which is in bracket and underscore. Okay, so ovary is superior, monocarpellary. So here you can see a picture of opened spikelet or flower, a single floret. So here you can see the gloom 1 and gloom 2. So this is outer gloom, this is inner gloom. Inside the gloom you are having this three anthers, first, second and another one is third here. And inside that you are having your bifid feathery stigma. So lemma is there, which is present inside the this inner gloom or second gloom, which bears the on. While pilea is smaller. So perfect flower consists of two glooms, one hairy lemma, small pilea, small on, three stamens, two lodicules, and one pistil. So here you can see the floral formula of this sessile spikelet as well as pedicellate spikelet. So in case of sessile spikelet, we are having a two gloom. Here you can see gloom 1, gloom 2. Inside this gloom, we are having a lemma and pilea. So gloom 2 consists of your lemma, while then we are having here pilea, 3 anthers and 2 lodicules and 1 single ori. While in case of pedicellate spikelet, we are having gloom 1, gloom 2. There is a lemma, but pilea is absent. So we don't have a pilea in case of pedicellate flower. Then we are having here 2 lodicules and 3 anther. So this flower is staminate. So ori or gynoecium is absent in case of pedicellate flower. So here you can see the structure: gloom, then pilea, then lemma. So lemma always bears a on. So on bearing structure is called lemma. Then you can see the structure of ori. So this is a ori, style and bifidary stigma. This is anther. So if you dissect a flower and if you mount like this, you can see outer gloom, inner gloom, then you are having a bract sometimes. At the each spikelet you are having a bract, then on bearing structure is called lemma and the small pilea which is present inside the your outer gloom. Then we are having 2 lodicules, then 3 anthers, versatile condition, and gynoecium. So ori, style, stigma. So in reality these are the original shapes. So flower is so small, so each part you have to observe carefully. The next point is flower biology and crossing. So the flowering occurs prior to sunrise and extended up to midday. The blooming start from tip of the panicle in downward direction, so from top to base. The stigma is receptive before flowering and remains receptive for near about 6 to 8 days. Pollens are viable for few hours and fertilization is completed within 2 to 4 hours of pollination. Jawar or sorghum is normally a self-pollinated crop, but stigmas are exposed before dehiscence, which leads to near about 6 to 30% of cross-pollination, and therefore it is also sometimes called as a often cross-pollinated crop. So the glooms open due to swelling of this lodicules, because lodicules are capturing the moisture, and due to swelling of lodicules, glooms are going to be open and another come out the stigma. Due to that one, due to open glooms, stigma come out through those glooms, which remain receptive for 8 to 16 days after blooming. So here you can see, so direction of anthesis, which start from top to base. So first you can see anthesis will take place in top portion, and that will be continue towards the base. So you can see due to swelling of lodicule, there will be opening of gloom takes place, which result in the extrusion of anthers as well as stigma through this spikelet or this floret. So this floret, you can see this bifidary stigma is come out. So extrusion of stigma is takes place. So next point is emasculation. So three different methods are used for emasculation, such as hand emasculation, then hot water emasculation method, then plastic bag emasculation and male sterility. So these are the techniques we can use for emasculation purpose. So material required is paper pollinating bags, then small bags of paper, stapler, knife, marking pencil, forceps, clips, small scissors, hot water storage container, thermometer, plastic or rubber sleeves, polythene bags, string and tag. So first one is a hand emasculation. So in this one we have to select the floret here which are to be opened before the anther dehiscence. So only the part of peduncle is emasculated. It is not possible to emasculate the whole panicle. So flowered tips and lower branches are removed by clipping with the help of scissor. So those unwanted panicle part that we are not going to do emasculation, we have to remove it by clipping. Near about 50 florets we are maintaining on your panicle, which is going to be flower or which is going to be emasculated and covered with suitable paper bag. The second method is hot water method. So in this method what we are doing, we are taking a hot water containing storage container which carries near about 45 to 48 degree Celsius heated water, and we are immersing sorghum head or panicle inside that container for 10 minutes without making injury to the stigma. So here you can see after how we have to select the panicle for hand emasculation. So the panicle just come out from the flag leaf, such type of panicle we have to select. After selection we have to remove all the open spikelet which is present on the panicle with the help of scissor, and only 50 to whatever you how many you want to do emasculation, that only florets we are maintaining. So if there is a viable pollens on the hands, so scissor or any emasculating tool, they are rinsed with water, then we have to hold the on between the finger and the forceps like this. Press the gloom laterally and remove all the three stamens. So here you can see with the help of needle and forceps we have to open the floret, and after opening with the help of forceps three anthers we have to remove from each floret. After that you have to go for a bagging. So bag the panicle and do a proper tagging. So likewise you can go for a hand emasculation. Then plastic bag emasculation. So in this method the panicle we have to cover with plastic bag. This create high humidity inside the bag, and due to which your florets open and anthers emerge out, but shed no pollens. So you have to give simply tapping with the help of your fingers, or you have to do the knocking, so that after knocking or tapping these anthers are removed. They will fall inside the bag, so you have to remove that bag, so thereby your emasculation will be takes place. So in this method sometimes there are chances of occurrence of selfing, so be careful when you are using. So proper care should be you have to done. So likewise you have to cover the whole panicle with plastic bags. Then next point is pollination. So after emasculation you have to do a pollination on next day between 9 to 10 am. So all flowers come to bloom. You have to insert and shed the head in the bag in order to collect the pollen from selected male parent. So you have to do a bagging of selected male parent's panicle, you have to do shaking. So after shaking, what happen? Pollens are going to be fall in your bags. So you have to then take out the bag, and that pollens we can use for a pollination. Or another technique is simply clipping the head early in the morning, then placing those head or flower in the boxes or flower pots, which also leads to the and that panicles we can use for a emasculation purpose. So the collected pollens we can directly dust on over exposed stigma, or with the help of brush we can apply them to the emasculated heads. Then another technique is male sterility. So in case of sorghum, the cytoplasmic genetic male sterility is used for production of hybrid plants. So in this case we have to select two lines, that is male sterile line and male fertile one. So one is a female parent and one is a male parent. So here we need not to go for a emasculation process. So we have to select a male sterile line just before the anthesis. Then we have to cover the entire panicle with paper bag and staple near the base. So panicles of same maturity group are bagged in order to pollinate the male sterile parent. Then pollen you have to collect from the selected male parent, and that we can dust or with the help of your hairbrush we can apply them. Or normally we can go these plants side by side, so there will be random pollination takes place. So after dusting of pollen, you have to again bag it and label it the female parents' panicles. So next one is selfing. So sometimes if you want to produce a self-fertilized plant, so for that purpose also we are using two techniques, that is first one is bagging and another one is a isolation. So paper bags are used. So when your flower reach to the or emerge out from the flag leaf sheath, we have to do the bagging of those flower heads or panicles, likewise shown in picture. Then we are making a cross sign on this bag, so you can know that this panicle is self. Okay, or sometimes we are providing isolation distance of near about 200 meter, so that will also result in the self fertilization. So we are avoiding chances of getting contamination of foreign pollens by providing this isolation, and thereby you get a self fertilized seeds. The next point is breeding objective. So in sorghum generally the breeding will be carried out for higher grain yield, early maturity, resistance to drought traces, then resistant to diseases, insect, pest, and breeding for quality. The next one is breeding methods. So in sorghum we will utilize the breeding method. These are introduction, selection, hybridization, population improvement, etc. Then breeding accomplishment. So in sorghum there are so many varieties are released for like improved one as well as hybrid ones. So examples are given here. So Phule Yashoda, Swati, these are the improved varieties, while CSH 14, CSH 9, CSH 13, 16, 18, these are the hybrid varieties. So this is all about your sorghum emasculation and hybridization techniques. Thank you.